G'day YouTubers. Welcome to this follow-up of the previous video I did on the college power supply project. I went through and tested various insulation methods and way of connecting the power transistor to the heatsink, and then I did a bit of testing to see what the temperatures got up to see what the best combination was. A lot of you came back for one and said you'd like to see the mica washer with heat compound to see how that compares. You then also said you'd like to see, you think it'd be better with the fan blowing onto the power transistor rather than drawing air away from it. So we're going to do those experiments. What I have realized, I've got everything set up today as I had it with the, I've got the silicon washer with the heatsink compound as I had it at the end of the previous video. But because the ambient temperature is different, maybe things have settled in on the heatsink, temperatures are a lot lower than they were for the same settings. So I'm going to play around with those to get them up to the same temperature. So that means I'm going to dial things up with the current and the voltage to get the temperatures up to the same level. And then we'll do a test with the air being drawn away from the heatsink so that we've got a reference temperature there. And then to see if it improves where the air is being blown onto and against that power transistor. After that, as I said, I'll put the mica washer with heatsink compound. A big thanks to Chris of Analyze IR. You remember I introduced him and his company plays around with analyzing IR remotes and what have you. And he kindly sent me 4 10K Burns or Born, I think they pronounce Born's potentiometers. I've got 2 of them hooked up at the moment and they work a treat. So a big thanks to you, Chris. Then also what I've got connected, previously I've got the same multimeters, I've got the Agilent and the Fluke 87, but the main meter monitoring the power transistor is the Xtec GX900. Now the reason I introduced this and I mentioned I'm going to do a full review on it, is that for one, for filming, it's got a nice backlit color display, so I thought for fun I'd include it, but it also has got Bluetooth and will send the readings to my phone. And last time, this test took me a long time. There's a lot of waiting around and I was kind of running down here all the time to double check the temperatures to see if it had settled. And this transmits those readings to my phone remotely when I'm around the house upstairs. So it seems to have very good range, even though it's only Bluetooth. So I'll just quickly show you that, as I must say, for this application, this kind of testing, very useful. Before we get started with the testing, I'll just show you. So these are the pots that Chris sent me. Very nice. You can really tell the difference in quality from them. I'll try and look them up and perhaps put a link below to where they can be purchased and what price they're at. We are going to do, as we get to the finishing stages of this project, I'm going to go through all the options of how you can interconnect various different sorts of pots, whether you're going to use 10K pots, which have kind of just got probably a 300 degree turn range, or these ones which have got 10 turn, how you can link them up together to give you the various possibilities. And then we'll try and share, again, from input from yourselves, all the best options and the best pricing for these, because I know these can be very expensive. Then before we get into the testing, I just want to demonstrate, I have got the phone in the background. You can see what the temperature on the power transistor is at the moment. I'm going to bring you in closer to that as we get to the multimeter. There is still a problem with high frequency switching or noise on that power transistor. I'm going to switch off the lights because I just want to demonstrate how I know. For one, if I change the kind of voltage range, I can hear a little bit of squealing. So at the moment, I still haven't got it quite sussed. You can just see this LED, and I'm just adjusting the settings on my camera. You can just see the current control LED is being dimly lit. I've noticed this as a side effect when you do get that high frequency switching, is that that switching is being drawn through to the op amps, and this is being switched on at a kind of rate of speed, so it's illuminated. So I know that's still there. That's something we're going to deal with soon in the next videos. Then over here, I've got the Xtec GX900, the Agilent, and the Fluke. As noted, this one's got the Kelvin tip or measurement probe sat right on the power transistor. The temperatures previously, I've got in the background, you might be able to see my electronic DC load. We're pulling about 3.5 watts, so the voltage is slightly higher. I'm going to drop that, and we're going to play around and get the temperatures up to what they were. But previously, for this combination of the silicon washer and heat compound, it was sitting at 48.1 degrees, 44 and 40. So 44 was the back of the heat sink, 40,
40.1 was assigned. Remember, these remained fairly consistent through all the testing. The ones on the actual power transistor were the more interesting ones. So I want to get back up to that temperature before applying the fan again, and then we'll have some reference temperatures to see which way works best, whether the fan should be drawing air away or blowing it onto the power transistor. But let me just demonstrate, and this, I've rarely come across tools or meters, multimeters or what have you, which have got a Bluetooth application which work really nicely. I've tested one of the other X-Tek applications with a tool, and it didn't work as well. But this one works like a treat. You can set it so that you can record samples onto your phone. You can set a sample rate. You can set all kinds of parameters. This is what we'll go over in detail when I do the review. You've got a graph, so I can see over time what's happening with the graph. When you tilt the phone sideways, you can either get a big display of the temperature reading, and if I get my hand out the way, you'll see the updates happen fairly quickly between the two. If I turn it the other way, you then get a nice representation on the graph. It'll then go and trend over time, and I can literally wander around the house and see what's going on. It's got another feature which some may think is gimmicky, but it can be really handy. And I'll just switch it on.
36.5. 36.6.
So you can switch on a voice to read out the readings to you, and that could be really helpful if you're in a situation where you're trying to make adjustments to something, but your display of either the phone or the multimeter screen is out of view. You can have that voice on and make adjustments and hear when you're getting to the reading that you want. So a very handy feature. More of this I'll display in the full review. So far, I must say, I've been really chuffed with the performance. I will say I've gone and placed lithium cells inside this because it does chew through cells. If you've got Bluetooth on or you're doing data logging, just like the Fluke 287, 289 chews through cells, you need to kind of have lithium cells if you want decent life out of this. But anyway, let's get to the testing. I'm going to drop the voltage take it down from 3.5 volts, because then we know we've got a higher voltage drop across the power transistor. I want to get this up to around 48 degrees Celsius, and then we'll start our testing. If you look in the back again, I know you can't see my hand adjusting on the pot, but you get really fine adjustment with these multi-turn pots. So I'm gonna turn things down. At the moment, I've got things at about half a volt and 1.3 amp. The temperature is slowly going up, as you can see. So I'm going to actually wander off and let this settle. Once we've got it settling around 48 degrees C, I'll come back and we'll start the testing with a fan. We've reached a point where things are relatively stable. It stays around 48 point whatever. It jumps from about 0.2 to about 0.56. If I pull up my phone, again, I know the adjustment on the camera is not that brilliant, but as soon as I'm getting a steady straight line along here, I know we had a kind of stable point. I've got the fan attached. I've made some more notes that we're going to check the silicon plus compound second test. I'm going to note the temperatures that I've got displayed on the meters now. And then, so that'll act as our first basis reference. We're then going to have fan blowing out and then fan blowing in. So we'll get a reference again with it blowing out as I had it previously, and then what you guys suggested, having it blow in, and we'll do a comparison with the figures. I've just powered up the fan. It's on its lowest setting. So that's what we use as a benchmark, the kind of low setting where it's just lightly blowing air. And if we take a look, you can already see that from the graph. I can see it's dipping off. We can see the temperature is changing, so I'm going to wander away, and once I get to the point where I see the graph is at a steady straight line again and it's stabilized, we'll come back and note the temperatures. Okay, so things have settled in. It seems to be settling around the kind of high 41s or the low 42 degrees C's. The graph, you can see here, it's got to a point where the range goes from 38 to 46, so it covers off. You can quite easily see when it's doing a small part of a degree C on that graph, and I can see where it's kind of just been gently rolling up and down around the 42 value. So I'm going to take note of those figures, and then I'm going to switch the fan around. I'm going to leave everything intact, just turn the fan around, and we'll see what difference it makes to the temperature. So out of interest, that's about 6 degrees C difference between the setup without the fan to what we've got the fan blowing on right now. And if I look at the previous reading, it was around 42.1, I've noted 42.2, so not far off there. There are some differences on the back and the side of the heatsink that could be to do where perhaps I've got the measurement probes in a slightly different position, but there seems to be a good correlation with the temperature on the power transistor. So I'll just flip the fan around. Things have settled down. I've got the fan blowing the air in. You can see I've switched it round, and indeed, it does make a difference. So we were sitting around 42.2. This has been hovering around the high 39s, perhaps just on 40, so at least 2 degrees lower, which again, if temperatures are higher or if you've got the fan blowing at a higher speed, there may be a greater differential there, but it certainly seems to be better. To my surprise, I thought drawing air away would be better, but no, blowing air onto it does seem to be better. So what I'm gonna do, I'll note the figures of the various multimeters. Then next, I've got in my hand ready, we're going to set a benchmark temperature with just the micro washer again. Obviously, things are different from the previous setup, so I need another benchmark temperature just with the micro washer. And then I'll go and apply compound to both sides to see what difference that makes. I've gone and cleaned everything up and applied the micro washer without any heatsink compound. So I'll fire things off. And just out of interest, if you look at the graph, you can see things are stepping up fairly quickly. So I'm going to go away again and wait till things settle in, and they're just going in a straight line, and then we'll take the measurements. Okay, we're at the point where things have settled down. I was almost caught off guard. What I have been doing is double checking the readings with a thermal imager against what I'm getting on the meter to make sure that they're within a degree or so of each other. What I discovered was there was a big difference. I noticed the reading was a bit low on the meter and there was a bit of a bubble. The thermocouple had pulled back and there's a little bubble that had formed under the insulation tape. So there's a fair bit of difference. I've pushed it down and now we're near enough, close enough, depending on exactly where this is pointing, so that we've got a good temperature reading. So as you can see, it's higher. I'm going to note these temperatures, apply the heat compound, and see where we get to with that. I'll just show you the readings that I have noted. So I've noted the transistor is sitting at 55 degrees, the back of the heatsink 38.6, the side at 35.9. Now these are a fair bit different to previously. It was close to 12 degrees or more than 12 degrees higher previously. And there's obviously a little bit of difference at the back and the side of the heatsink. Now ambient was higher at that point in time, so that would play a little role. Depending on where I place the probe on the transistor, that obviously can play a role. And the one thing I will note, which I noted now, which is where, again, you have to be very careful. Me doing these little small subtle changes in the setup can affect the measurements, which is why I'm doing all the measurements again. I was using, in the last setup, as I recall, I was using press stick underneath the heatsink just to keep it stable so it wouldn't fall over. This time I've got the heatsink directly on this kind of metal base, and I can tell there is some heat which is being extracted into this metal base. So it's helping to sink a little more heat away from the heatsink. And I think that's what's also probably having the greatest effect on reducing the temperature on the power transistor. But nonetheless, all the rest of the measurements have been done in the same way. So at least we can have a comparison this time round. So let me get that heatsink compound applied. We're all ready to go for the final test. I've got heatsink compound on there. I've managed to clean it up so there's not too much mess. I'll just pull you out and I'll kick things off and we'll see how they settle up. It looks like we've reached a state of equilibrium, so I'm going to note the temperatures at what they are at the moment. It certainly is less than the setup with the silicone washer and heat paste or heat sink compound. So that's interesting. I'd say I need to have a margin of potentially a degree or two of where I place the probe and what have you, potentially that does seem to run at a lower temperature. So I'll just pull up the book and we'll have a look at the end results. So just to summarize, this is where we started testing today with the same setup that we left off last time, silicon compound. This is the second reading. I set it up so we were around roughly around the same temperature. So that's where that settled in as a reference. We then used the fan blowing out. It dropped it down from the 48.4 to 42.2 with it blowing in on the TO3 package, the power transistor. It dropped down to 39.7. So that blowing in, that was certainly something I wasn't expecting and you guys asked me to try. So that certainly worked out. Then we tried just the microwasher by itself. That went up to 55 degrees Celsius. And then with the microwasher and compound, it went down to 44.3. So that was certainly lower than the initial setup I had, which was sitting around 48 degrees. And the interesting here, which might be a clue that there's perhaps better thermal transfer, is if we note the temperature of the heatsink was at 35.6 and 34, and here it was 39.8 and 37, so it was higher. So it seems like more heat was being taken away from the transistor and being dissipated out through the heat sink. So perhaps this microwasher, I said I had a preference to the silicone. It's far easier to work with. It's far more robust than those microwashers, but it does look like, pending any slight error on my test setup, that the microwasher and compound are probably a better setup. Before we end off, and again, I know this isn't a review of that multimeter, but I just thought I'd show you. I used the record function for the last kind of temperature test. So if we go back and then we get to the main screen, this is where it can find, it'll search for devices and it can actually see the multimeter over there. You can set up settings for the interval you want to record at and what have you, or you can go to measure where you get the measurements, but there's an open button down here. And I'll just open up the file that I was recording to. And there we go. It gives you a kind of summary of the information. Let's just see. It tells you the number of samples, the duration, the frequency. It was every 10 seconds. It's giving you a min and a max. It was 23, heavens, it's going down to four places there. 23.3999 and 44.5999. It gives you a mean, a standard deviation, an average, so a whole lot of samples there. You get the opportunity to export it. We'll take a closer look at that in review. And then what I really find nicely, and I'll probably have to flick it the other way, there we go, is a nice graph trend over time. That live graph, the one thing I was missing, I wish that while it was doing the live graphing, I could have changed the time scale because things were just going by a little too quickly. But here, once you've gone and recorded it, you can see you can tap and go and see individual temperatures and times at certain points along the graph. You can scroll along the timeline and see how things trended along the way. So I must say, I really, at this point in time, am enjoying the features and functionality of that multimeter, but we'll see what it's cracked up to be once we get it under full review. I will just note, you'll see my battery very low. This battery would normally be sitting easily around 70%, but having the Bluetooth on the whole time has certainly sapped the juice out of it while I've been going through this exercise.
So thanks very much for the prompting. I know some of you obviously did prompt at the end of those last tests to say try those, and I think a worthwhile exercise because there certainly are some differences there to note. Thanks very much to Chris again for the pots. These are really nice. As I said, we will go into more detail on the configuration of the various pots for making adjustments once we start getting to the final stages. I think I've still got a little problem to sort out with some of the noise on the transistor, but that will follow up in the next video. Thanks very much, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.